my general point, which partly motivated by pure mathematical issues, partly by application, is that probability theory, probability is not a number assigned to something, but rather, I say the word functor, though it's not exactly a functor, from category, which is not quite a category, of complicated object to something relatively simple. And we have events in the world, and we assign to them numbers, and numbers make a category, positive numbers. And that's with certain properties, and that is probability theory. But in many instances, and which application I won't discuss, like in biology or in linguistics, this, because the set of events is structured in a rather tricky way, very differently from physics. It's highly non-homogeneous, so it's organized in a less elegant way, but still quite powerfully. And the range where probability takes place, it is not a number. It's something which is not quite clear what, and the parallel which you may draw from pure mathematics is homology theory, when you start with category of topological spaces, you complicated things, but what you assign to them are abelian groups, or even better, vector spaces of a field, and this is something you feel much more comfortable with. They measure, in a way, they serve for measuring your objects. And one of the ways to create such theories out of what you know is linearization. Okay, so, and one of these kind of standard ways to generalize theories is linearizing them. And just one of them, just the point I was making, entropy and some aspects of the entropy are linearizable. And the simplest instance of that is what I was stating was the Lebesgue theorem. Isoperimetric inequality is quite respectable because it has lots of consequences, says in a form which we want to generalize as follows. We have a product of sets, of finite sets, that actually may be infinite, but and we have a subset there, which is Y. And we project it to different products. We project, you can see the Y. So we write this Y sub J will be a projection of Y. And this sitting at the product of all I and J. Right? So there is projection from X. I'm sorry. Yeah. That's correct, yeah. So X projects to all this. X sub I, X sub J. This is. And Y projects. And then cardinality of the set related by some inequality, namely the cardinality. And so now for the case of Lebesgue theorem, we only project, so we drop only one index at a time. So we project here, we project here, and so there are projection of the coordinates hyperplane on the top dimensional, so to speak. So there are n of them, and so you can call them maybe x, I, drop, meaning this index being dropped, and accordingly we have this y projection I being dropped, and their cardinality, their product of those cardinalities, and it's better to normalize them to the power 1 over n, greater or equal than cardinality of y, if my normalization is correct. If my coordination is not correct, I guess. I think this is the correct power. Yes, that's correct. So you take in these powers, this projection, so each of them projects on all products but one, so one is missing. So a total number of them will be equal to, say, n is cardinality of I. So So I'll put here n minus 1. Total number of them is n. But for example, dimension 3, the first example to have in mind, you take power as 1 half. So we have subset in Euclidean space. You project it on three coordinate planes. Then product of areas in power is 1 half bounds the volume of the set, which is discrete and continuous. One goes to another, coming in a trivial way. And then this has kind of, I'm using generalization. So this is a Lebesgue inequality, which is actually become more transparent if you generalize it. And this generalization is called shared lemma. And it is as follows. So we consider function alpha on J's. So this is a function which takes value in real numbers, positive real numbers, for all J and I. Yeah? So we consider the following function, which is called a partition of unity if if not mistaken, and now because I have no idea, because alpha and take it here, chi of J equals 1. So you replace each J by character indicator function of this set. So function 0, 1. And you take this sum. So when you, in other words, when you consider this set J and see how many times they cover a particular point and take them this way as A alphas, sum must be 1. So it's called partition of unity. Yeah? In particular, our choice here, these all exponents were equal, and this exactly makes partition of unity. So in dimension 3, we have 3 points, so we have 3 sets, and each of them covered twice, so we have to take 1 half to have partition of unity. And then the corresponding inequality says that if you take product of cardinalities of y sub j to the power alpha of j, this will be greater or equal than cardinality of y. And this is a shared lemma. Again, I don't know exactly the history when, how, and where it was exactly stated in which context. And it's kind of people love it in a information theory and formulated in a form incomprehensible for mathematicians. But it is it formal consequence of strong sub-additivity of entropy. So first you can strengthen this. Instead of taking this projection, you take push-forward measures, which are entropies. So you replace them by smaller entities, each of them. And still inequality holds true, because here, of course, because subsets is the same as its own entropy. But then project it, and it still remains true. And then for these entropies, so if you just apply the strong super-additivity to all kind of covering by pairs of sets, yeah, each of them, to each of these blocks you apply and use what is called inclusion-exclusion principle. You start counting, and you get this inequality. It's still kind of nice consequence of that, but still kind of completely formal. It's just linear, you know, A plus B mathematics. However, it's nice statement. But and what I'm using, it has linearization, in which I want to formulate topologically, which is kind of easier to formulate, because it becomes much more close to what we have. Namely, now let X, I's be topological spaces. That kind of simple space, maybe Euclidean space, but just they're complex, just that, but still they have topology, like circles, you know, or whatever. And you can see their product as before, and do everything we're doing before. Now we have this subset, say open or closed, yeah, subset Y in X, and you project it. So all this product, call them xj, product only by I from j. And then the same inequality holds if this understood as rank of homologous or cohomology of these spaces with coefficient in some field. And in case, of course, of a discrete set, it will be the same. But in general, something significantly more general, there is like much more possibilities, of course. So, and this has nothing to do at this stage, has little to do with topology. It's pure linear algebra. And the only thing which is relevant is that homology of such a product with coefficient in the field is just tensor product of corresponding vector spaces of each representing homology of each of them. And then so that's all we should use. And you see that it's, and you see, but it's a kind of ugly thing to do, right? You have a space and you project set, and projecting image of a set is a bad thing, of course, in topology. Yeah, it's definitely something wrong. So you would say, hi, I would prefer to speak about rank of corresponding homomorphism. And then it's become not true. Because you make cancellation, yeah, even in zero-dimensional case, homology and the projection may go to zero. However, it doesn't go to zero if there is some positivity. And so in algebraic geometry, for example, it's still being preserved if you work with a, not with homology, but with a Chow group, with a ring of cycles, when there is built-in positivity. So positivity is kind of crucial, but there I don't know if you can make an entropic version of that. You see, this algebra geometric version is not, it has no entropic counterpart, at least no apparent entropic. There is no strong subadditivity in this language. It just fails to be true. There are counterexamples. But they're so special counterexamples that there must be still probably a right theorem. But this theorem is true, and this is a starting point what we want to understand. So what we want to understand, what we want to say, that homology in some respects, when you have a space X and you have open subsets, then homology of this with some coefficients of cohomology with fixed coefficient field, I prefer speaking with cohomology of U, in many respects behaves as measure. There is some kind of additivity. And of course, the homology theory has built-in additivity, which is like exact sequences or Weitori's formulas, which are make it looking like a measure, which in fact I don't know how to fully use. So I will be using very little part of that, right? And but the point is that if you have all this property in homology, you can say, well, we know everything, there are spectral sequences, and we know everything. But from a certain point of view, we know zero, because this is like in measure theory, we know everything about real numbers. But we don't, it doesn't mean he knows anything about measures, right? The only starting point from which you can make formulating problem, but not proving anything, right? And so let me explain so what I have in mind. The point essential in probability theory, when you do interesting problem, you always have infinite processes. And this infinity is organized in a certain way, right? It's not just infinity, right? Infinity structured in a certain way, very often by action of a group. You have an infinite group, and something happens homogeneously, stochastically along the group, and you want to understand what happens. And here, it's a kind of similar situation. You want to consider a similar situation, and just look at very simple examples. So, to see that something, this I gave one example of this, where topology was not quite simple, but is continuing with this example. Look at very simple. So we want to consider kind of homogeneous situation when you have infinite families of topological spaces, and sometimes maybe even infinite dimensional spaces. And we want to understand this asymptotic behavior of their topology when dimension goes to infinity. And so the simplest example would be have a space X, and you take it large power n, and n goes to infinity. Let's look already at this very simple example. And we want to understand how homology behaves. And again, my homology or cohomology always is a fixed coefficient field. You take this, and you know that this will be tensorial power of this, and in particular Poincaré polynomial of this space, meaning polynomial with coefficients of Betti numbers, right, bi meaning ranks of homology in certain dimension, become power polynomial. And the question is, what is asymptotic behavior of coefficients? And of course, even for binomial, it is these numbers. The asymptotic is exactly what is given by Boltzmann rate formula. So I would think that this formula is asymptotic behavior given in terms of entropy. So in fact, there is some specific formula saying how they go. Of course, traditional proof, you just apply Stirling formula, which is absurd, because in Stirling formula, which about n factorial, there are two terms. It's n to the n, and then there is an exponential term, yeah? Something like e to the n. Like the basic, but this cancels. This major term for asymptotic cancels in there, right? And so only this remains. So it's clearly that Stirling formula completely wrong way to do that, yeah? Which is, on the other hand, of course, if you know the formula, you're inclined to do that. But this is exactly what I'm saying. Should be prohibited of doing, right? Because it completely distorts the picture. And on the other hand, this is, if you think about that in terms of entropies, it's clearly is the number of state of certain system. And if you think about this a little bit, you see it's actually entropy as defined by Boltzmann in terms of his kind of the alternative definition. And this is how Boltzmann proved it. But again, you could think it was known to Euler, but I look at that on the internet. There are some articles by Euler about that, but he doesn't prove that. He writes specific formulas for different binomial coefficients, for general polynomials, for certain kind of polynomials, but it doesn't seem he was concerned with these asymptotics. So I'm curious who first found asymptotics of binomial coefficients, because this is, of course, the core of large deviation theory. All large deviation theory is just a elaboration of that. It's just, in a way, once you know that, the rest you kind of know what to do. Right? So this is the key in one most fundamental Hessian probability, asymptotics of binomial coefficients. And for general polynomials, slightly trickier, but still certainly not hard, such as polynomial one variable. So you know how they are formed, you can write these formulas. And so even asymptotics of this coefficient are not completely trivial, slightly probabilistic in its nature. However, the issue which appear usually in probability when you have discrete sets and their powers and everything refer to kind of zero-dimensional homology, here automatically you have the kind of the pleasure dealing with all dimensions. So the thing become graded, and there are all dimensions. The picture becomes much more interesting. And so let's see what we can say about it. So our object is x to the n. N very large, going to infinity, but I prefer to think about that. It's not infinite now, but infinitely large, but still integer. And we want to measure sets by their topology. And so what would be the good measure? Just their own topology is not quite right, yeah, because kind of physically, you think, this basic example for us, at this moment, will be N torus. Or I better to say it, torus to the power set, because we can imagine you have set, on which you have an M molecule, where the state of set of states of this molecule is a circle. Altogether, you have the kind of very large piece of a crystal, and each of this imagining this being non-interacting, which is of course very rare in physics. So physicists would never consider that. It's kind of trivial if they don't interact, but still, even that indistinct, and interaction is kind of another matter. And topology, instead of saying the measure of probability of event, you want to know how many motions a particular state may have, right? So we constrain our picture by some way we observe, and for us it may be some open set inside of this torus to the power n, or rather power I. This is, and it's how much motion we will see, how particles can move. Here, of course, motion are rather simple. They don't interact. The motion don't intertwine. It's kind of trivial case. Yet, as we see, there are many open questions here. And there are some results. And so, what is the correct way of measuring? Right, so, and the way of measuring seems to me the best. So there are two competing kind of way of measurements, which sets are large and which are small. So if you have just in the Euclidean space, such space, and we take tiny little holes, of course, we have lots of topology. But they can fake, yeah, of course, if you erase them, they're not monotone, yeah, we erase these points, which you removed. So add them back, set become larger, homology becomes smaller. So this you cannot use. You need some monotonicity. And of course, so what you do, you consider, instead of that, first definition. It is a rank of homomorphism, cohomology homomorphism of the whole X to Y. So rank of this homomorphism. Now, of course, it's better because it's monotone with a set. So you have positive function, which is it has this monotonicity. But it also has some, this is already not so bad, and we shall may be used. But the better measurement, in fact, is somewhat different, and which has more kind of measure kind of behavior. And it is what we do. We take our set U, and we take rank it's a rank of the kernel of the homomorphism from X. It was Y. I was calling the mu now, yeah? The kind of open sets, so to mean, from X to complement to U on the cohomology level. So, another way to say it, you look, so we have this subset in the big space, and you ask which cohomology of the big space is representable by core chains with support in this set. Right? And which corresponds, again by elementary topology, to the kernel of the map and the kernel of the map of the, on the complement. Right? So it's a rank of cohomology of the ambient space representable by cochains which vanish outside of this set. And since this behaves in many respects like a measure, and it has some nice additivity property with respect to cup product. Now, cohomology, what is nice, it's not only kind of something you can add. So the object, so you assign now, the true kind of way to say it, you don't assign to set a number, but you assign to each set exactly this kernel itself. So it's ideal, great ideal in cohomology algebra. You take homomorphism from ambient space X to cohomology of the complement. So your measure takes values not in numbers, but in ideal, in graded ideals of this cohomology algebra. And with respect to them, it has, you know, you can add ideals, you can multiply ideals, and it has this. And the basic formula, which is systematically used, is that if you take, so this you call measure. Call this, I put somewhere some stars, so it's not usually measure of U. Right? And this measure of, I hope I'm not confusing it, it has some, I was, see, yes, it's what I'm saying is a reinterpretation of the Lebesgue-Schneiderman theorem, that if I have, so one vanishes here, and another vanishes here, then the cup product vanishes on the union, right? So we have two cohomology classes. One vanishes somewhere, and another vanishes somewhere else. We multiply them, and vanishes in the product, of course. This kind of, but this is kind of the Lebesgue-Schneiderman theorem, which has lots of applications, kind of obvious ones being said in these terms. But it's not at all consequence of this and obvious. And this for measure always forgetting, so I have to look, yeah, to put inequality in the right direction, because that's why I make it wrong. Let me. This is all what good about. I have no ability to remember formulas, even so simple ones. Always put the sign wrong. So it is said that mu1 and u2 is contained so, by taking the section of two sets, this is contained, or contains. Yeah, this is exactly what I was unable to remember, to put the right sign. It contains, yeah, you see. So this, remember, this ideals, this cup product. It's not union, it's cup product. There are these some additivity also. We have just joined sets. This thing is additive, by the way, which is kind of trivial. I mean, easy, but it's not that significant. But this novelty, which you don't have for usual measures, we have some extra formula. Yeah. I'm sorry. It's up. Yeah, it's for cohomology. Just remember, it's for cohomology. Absolutely right. That the. There is actually more to that, just in a. I may not explain it, that this not only. This kind of ideal, it's graded algebra, it's not only ideal, but also invariant and the action, if you work mod 2 or mod ZP, it's invariant and the action of corresponding standard algebra. So it's more structured, and that is again significant, plays a significant role, especially in the work by Larry Guth. Now, so what is a. What we know about that in the simplest example. So this is again, this is just background, but I'm using formula in the following. If you look, and this of course you can do it restricting this. You put here, or instead of that, you can put some number, which means it only refers to corresponding cohomology. But of course for product, you know what it will be. Yeah? So you can replace star by a specific index. And so there is the following theorem for the n torus. So if you have two sets, U1 and U2, and then so we can have to write it down because otherwise I do it wrong. Is there an inequality for that? Which is also in a way similar to isoperimetric inequality and how. And so you take this means the ranks and this less or equal to what the product. Of the numbers, of the Bayesian numbers times, these are Bayesian numbers of the torus themselves, so they are binomial coefficients, and here there is a coefficient C by which you multiply, and this C equals to something, so it's not that essential, but I write it, but then I have to explain it. And this constant C equals, I1 times I2, how much there? So n is our torus. These numbers, this is a constant c. But this inequality holds if the sets are disjoint. So we have two disjoint sets, then they cannot contain both too much homology. And of course, you say, you know, everything about homology, you have this, you know, all the sequences, ta ta ta. Still, you have to prove it. And the point is the way you prove it. So how I was proving that? So I just reduced this to something combinatorial. And then I was trying to find it in the literature, some combinatorial statement. And I was imagining all possible words. But of course, I could never guess that this was called corresponding combinatorial theorem was called Matsumoto Togishugi theorem. I mean, this is a horrible way how people call their theorem after the names. Who knows these names? Yeah. And I spoke to somebody in combinatorics, and he directed me to the right domain of mathematics. It's called extremal set theory. And you look at textbooks, and then you find lots of inequalities. And so this particular inequality, if your subsets are just union of tori, which are coordinate tori, which are product of circles. So then you can express it in terms of sets. And then you, using this property of cohomology, you reduce it to some property of the exterior algebra. And then going from exterior algebra to sets, well, that's, again, little simple argument there. But the point is, again, this is very much like the case of the Lebesgue inequality or Scherer lemma. Again, I'm using these names, which is, of course, yes, to say something, yeah. And otherwise, I have to invent, for any purpose, I try to invent actually some names for the theorem so they will have some meaning and then will be remembered, right? Because that's a name being attached, except for, no, Pythagorean theorem is okay, yeah, we can remember the name. But if it's come to somebody proven yesterday, if it's really a good theorem, only exceptionally, name is okay. Yeah. So, that you start with something combinatorial, then kind of linearizes, and then become topological. And topological, say, in terms of linear algebra, in terms of this exterior algebra, I just don't remember how to formulate it, yeah? It's, you know, because you... And this, certainly, I'm pretty certain theorem is true not only for torus, but for all kind of spaces. But I'm not certain, because the corresponding... I think the rest combinatorial theorem have been proven. You need something more elaborate combinatorial theorem. But in general, it's unclear what are kind of full set of such inequalities. So you have configuration of sets, so this is a problem, yeah. I can formulate as follows. So we consider that n goes to infinity. And you can see the configuration of sets in this X sub n. They're indexed by the same, all with the same number, 2. My I, of course, not the same as it was before. Yeah. Just here we have 2 subsets. Now some configuration of subsets. And what we know of them, you know who intersect whom. And all data which you have. Or, which is more important, who is disjoint from whom. And then the question is, what are possible measures, in my sense, of these sets? So how much topology of the ambient space they can absorb, asymptotically when n goes to infinity, approximately. And this is not so clear. I mean, it's reduces to some question in polylinear algebra. And sometimes you can reduce it to combinatorial question, sometimes not. Sometimes it's the corresponding reduction look questionable. And then you arrive at some combinatorial problem in this extremal set theory, which usually are unsolved, right? In this generality, I don't think it has been done. But that tells you something about the kind of problems we face here. Okay, now, so what we can do next? So this kind of a kind of warming up, but this warming up where I can prove something from some moment on, you can prove much less. And then, but you yes, only can make some definition and formulate questions. So one, of course, immediate issue which arises as in statistical mechanics, One way you say, aha, you have a big system, a limit of finite systems, you want to describe everything for finite systems and go to the limit. And alternatively, you want to work with infinite system to start with. And in statistical mechanics, if you just abstractly infinitely many objects, you cannot say anything. But if it's something like a lattice, namely have some group gamma acting on there, then everything must be done equivariantly with respect to gamma. For example, topologically, you have this infinite dimensional space. So it will be not just torus to power infinity, which is unclear what it is, what kind of what meaning it has, but it will be torus to the power of this group. So it will be a set of functions from group to this torus, which is acted upon by gamma, and you want to make this equivariant topology there. And the essential part of this topology is cohomology, is multiplicative structure. Additively, it's not that interesting. But multiplicatively, it's kind of the whole kind of essence of that, everything what I said, depends on multiplicative structure. Of course, this relatively simple space well, you can kind of, well, much of them derived from finite product, but still there are kind of issues which are not completely obvious here. However, on the next level, if you want to imitate what happens in physics when particles, when your factors interact, you have to introduce interactions. And then you follow the patterns of what is done in topological dynamics, in the all the symbolic dynamics. So in symbolic dynamics, in topological dynamics, you start with a, it will be not a torus, but a finite set. You take it to the power gamma, and here gamma acts, so it's infinite. Power this finite set and this power gamma x, and that out of this you can produce more interesting dynamical systems, namely what may be called Markov hyperbolic systems, which includes kind of classical hyperbolic systems like Anosov systems. This is done in two steps, and these steps can be imitated in this more geometric topological setting. The sets are as follows. First, you consider, these are called sometimes shifts, so I use the terminology of shifts. This is a kind of Bernoulli shift, right? We have, in particular, when gamma is integers, you have this finitely many symbols, this infinite words in the symbols, you move the basis and the words, infinite words move, yeah? First, you consider a subsystem, which is called subsystem of finite type, which is defined as follows. For any group, any countable group gamma, they define as follows. You take some subset in gamma, finite subset. So what you have in this context is a function with values in a set. Here it is finite set. Here is something like circle, something more interesting. And you say, looking at this one particular subset, which configuration you are being allowed? So you take only subset of this configuration. So you can say you add finitely many equations. If they're discrete, of course, equation makes no sense. If they're continuous, you can say, these are variables, finitely many variables, which come there, and they satisfy some equation. So this is a finite dimensional description, or even finite here, and then you say, now we consider only those function on the big, on the whole group, which satisfy this equation whenever you put this domain. You can shift it around the group and requires the same condition being satisfied everywhere, right? For example, we have here, you may say that everywhere this equal average of these two. And this is a kind of harmonic condition, like harmonic functions appear this way. The same condition everywhere, whichever. And these are called finite type subsets. That's a much of the symbolic dynamics is about that. Here you can do the same. Of course, for the torus, I don't know what it may be, but natural good candidates, when you expect something regularly happening, are, of course, algebraic varieties. So replace this torus by projective space projective space over complex numbers. And when you restrict it here, so you have this projective space, so here it's product of projective spaces, and there you take some algebraic subvariety. And this will be allowable, and then you move it around. And then you have kind of this infinite dimensional algebraic variety. And the simplest instance of that, when you run over integers, and then, of course, you can truncate it at every moment, and you have this finite dimensional variety, or you can do it periodically, another approximation. And you have this, again, finite dimensional variety. So given one single equation, you have this sequence of varieties, and the question is actually, what are their topology? What are their homology? What are their Betti numbers asymptotically? And this is unclear. I mean, I was asking many people in algebraic geometry, say, oh, well, we have all the theorems, because all theorems are just on the beginning. The theorems only to kind of like A plus B equals C. You have to make some hard work to understand how they behave. We know in algebraic geometry, topology is very stable. You move a little bit equation in some sense, topology doesn't change. So it's really a combinatorial kind of problem. There must be canonical answer depending only on degrees of your varieties. However, I mean, they may behave in a rather complicated way. And if it comes for a more complicated group, gamma, it may be enormously complicated. But for cyclic group, probably it's solvable. But if you start thinking about that, you see you run into rather kind of into a complicated mess. You know everything. You kind of have, for every finite stage, you have full picture. But the picture becomes more and more and more elaborate very fast. So, but this, I think, is an interesting question. However, maybe you will never get sharp answer. But and by the way, yeah, and another point, the way you can approach it, of course, if you work on a finite field, then if you reduce a prime p, you can see the prime p, and then you look at the points of a finite field, you come back to the Markovian chain. So you come to the classical dynamics. So it has kind of interesting interaction with dynamics and homology and so on. So this ranks of homologies in this space are closely related to entropies in the usual sense, in a kind of very precise way. However, the picture is far from being clear. However, it is not, yeah, and then maybe just to continue, to finish, to explain that this is not the end of the story, especially here, because here there is very nice next step, because you can consider the quotient of this. No. So this is a kind of traditional, this is less traditional. You can see the quotient of these finite type systems, and quotient must be understood, and again, in this category. Namely, so it's a quotient space of any space obtained by, can be introduced by means of an equivalence relation. An equivalence relation is a subset in the product of set by itself, right? So this equivalence relation, you take two of them, and you take subset here, and you say whom you have to identify. And you only work in the category of system of finite types, the way I describe them, so describable finite terms. So this subset, this equivalence relation R in there, must be also a finite type. On the other hand, it must be equivalence relation, right? It must have this quotient. And these are two properties which fight each other. It's very hard to have both of them. If you want to construct, and this, of course, must be, well, in this, everything automatically will be, of course, equivariant at the action of the group, right, the way this is described. So you want to produce equivalence relation of finite type, and that's very difficult to have, right? It's very hard to verify. It's like a metric. If you have a function and two variables, it's very difficult to say it's a metric or not. Kind of, it's really almost impossible. Right? It must be defined, and here it's quite difficult, and much of difficulty of dynamics problem, of dynamics come from that problem. So what are these systems? They're kind of hyperbolic system in this generalized sense. But here it's unclear what happens if you do it on this level of algebraic varieties, and it's unclear if it's significant. Yeah? But with there, maybe you still remain in the same category, which may be interesting. But that's not the main issue what I want to explain, because there is much more interesting class of systems where you can apply this approach, and they can be physically quite attractive. So these are all close to kind of non-interacting particles. So everything, what you can do there, even if they don't interact or interact in a kind of not very significant way. Hyperbolic system corresponds to that. But, so what you want to consider, what I call is parametric packing problem, which has much more juice to it. Not that it's more, the previous one not difficult enough, but there you have really difficulty just when you start doing here, there is more possibilities. So it's more difficult, but there are probably easier branches to that. And that starts with the classical packing. Yeah, so you have a bunch of balls in the Euclidean space, and you want to know how much you can put them with a given density. And it's unknown what kind of solution you should have, where the only where it's solved in a way only from in dimension 2 and 3. Yeah, for 2 it's classical, I've forgotten, going back to Legendre or Lagrange, that the optimal packing is hexagonal one, right, like that, yeah? So it has periodicity, and you know exactly what it is, and you know what it is. In high dimensions, you do this, you can put one layer over another. This was conjecture by attribute to Kepler. It was recently solved, I forgot the name of the guy, Hales, yeah, who solved it. And it's computer-aided proof. I'm not certain how much it accepted, yeah, and what computer-aided proofs say. In a way, I don't quite understand objection against computer-aided proofs, or rather, any proof obtained by computation which you cannot do in your head is like that, yeah? Somebody make a computation. The paper, I mean, how you trust the paper? Why should you trust the paper? I mean, it's a paper, I mean, it's physical means, not your brain, right? So, and so I don't see the big difference, yeah? And preferably to have arguments which don't require something you cannot have in your head, right? And long linearized strings of arguments are not good for your head. Well, of course, you may or may not accept it, but anyway, this is his solution. The solution is not that simple. Yeah, it's not periodic. Yeah, they don't have to be periodic. They kind of, but they're describable, all of them. And when you go to next dimension, you don't know what happens. Right, we don't know if they're periodic, but yeah, and most likely the extremal thing are non-periodic, and what they are and how they look, and whether they're entropy, heterotides. Lots of interesting questions arise here, but they're not what we want. We want to look at a coarser question, but which has more substance to it, in my view, is when density is far from being maximal. You consider both spread with some density which is far from being maximal. So yes, you have you know the density. So balls are distributed such that in a bigger ball they are proportion given to you. And you want to know topology of this space. So you consider all possible positions, and you want to know topology in a sense, just I was speaking about that, what is asymptotic behavior of homology. But even formulating it is not so obvious on one hand. But on the other hand, there are non-trivial kind of something non-trivial I can say already now about that. And the point is that topology here is by far more elaborate than already background topology. Language in which you want to have an answer will be much more elaborate than we had before. It's not just infinite tensorial power of some vector space, yeah? It's something more complicated. So let's make a little break and we come to this after the break. Okay, so that's an issue, yeah? So we want to understand this. And as I said, even formulating it is not totally obvious, yeah? And it has kind of obvious kind of physical interpretation. You have these moving balls, and you want to know how complicated the motion can be, and they can go one, you know, go like that, and this goes like that, and these orbits intertwine, and you want to kind of have a picture of all this complexity. And of course, this homological setting is a possibility to express it, but not the only one. There are kind of several ways how we can formulate it, and here I emphasize this homological, cohomological formulation, which is not the only one possible. So what is a general setting for that? So, and in physics, you know, people love energy, yeah? And so let's look from the point of view of energy and just try to make everything about energy also formulated in a appropriate language, and then we come back to the problem just to reformulate it in the more general terms. Right. So typically when you want to understand something, the only way to understand it is not, so there are two ways of understanding things. One, you focus on this and just, and on the other hand, you just go away. And experience shows if you focus on something, you never understand it, you know. But philosophers think, what is, you know, substance? What is it? That is just nowhere. If you go away, I mean, you come back and you understand it, or you understand that usually the question was stupid to start with. So, you have to go away, and we look at energy. And so what is energy? You have my notation may be not consistent, it will be x, and you have a space, and you have functions with real values, and this is for us energy. So how this is treated in statistical mechanics in very simplistic terms, this X is a probability space, a measure space, something like, they're all more or less the same, something like square. And you have a function to real numbers, and this has this density distribution. Usually spaces depend upon parameter, they're bigger and bigger chunks of matter. So you have the sequence of these distributions, but they're measures, after all, measures on the line, and you want to understand these measures. And for measures on the line, or if you have several observables, not one energy, several observables, you have measures on the Euclidean space. The first, what you do, you look at this entropy, this Boltzmann kind of entropy, what is asymptotic of decay of this when n goes to infinity. Usually they concentrate one point and then spread, become kind of very small. Otherwise, and then, yes, you do all this formalism of mechanics. And of course, the point is, my understanding, just all this mathematics is kind of trivial, but remarkably, it's very non-trivial for practical physicists or chemists or biologists. Yeah, you just, from that, you know what to measure, how to relate this kind of mathematics to, because quantities to something you physically can measure, etc. And if you throw this away from mathematical statistical mechanics, you become complete bore, in my view. You completely kind of pointless kind of exercises and computations. The essence is that it's related in non-trivial, in non-rigorous way to experiments. But we do mathematics, however, unfortunately. But what we do now, typically if you have this space with x to the n, very often is a power of fixed space, you have identical particles, many of them. It will be not this thing. It will be thing divided by symmetry group. And mathematically, it's inevitable. You have to divide by this group because you cannot make asymptotic with factorials. But you have binomial coefficients. As I said, factorial cancel off. You have exponential functions. And exponentials are just where you can make all these kind of formalisms of large deviations, which is now called, or which used to be, or just Gibbs kind of Gibbs formalism of statistical mechanics. And now, but now we do topology. So now X is not measure space, not probability space, but topological space. And we are concerned with topology of this space. And also, even it's a product, we have, for example, in the case of balls, everything determined by these points. So it will just power space if there are n points. And now the symmetry, you have a symmetry group acting. But division is quite different thing, yeah? When you divide in topology, you put two lines. And because you're concerned with homology and homotopy, you don't take set-theoretic equation, which is a stupid thing to do. We take homotopy-theoretic equation. So in a way that you remember what this symmetry do to your space, right? If you divide it by like that, topologically it becomes rather boring, and not always boring, but relatively. At least it's not what we want, because here in particular, when we have this box, these points are disjoint. So you're concerned maybe not so much with the space itself, but this minus all is diagonal. This meaning all diagonal. And here, division by the symmetry, by permutation group is the same no matter what you do, whether you put this second line or not. Because the action of the group has no fixed point there. And this is enormously complicated space topologically. Because this group is topologically very complicated. So group, in again, classical physics, is power of this group come via quantum mechanics, because it acts linearly, it has representations, and this representation corresponds to, offer to representation more interesting groups, and this corresponds to something I don't want to say, which I don't understand. But homologically, this also, the homology of this group, in particular, when it acts on a space, on a relatively simple space like that, this group X, the quotient space is quite complicated, quite elaborate homology. So I can say what they are. And they're kind of known, but there's textbooks about that, but I must admit I never quite read it, yeah? So I just couldn't extract from that information which I would like to know. For example, what's the asymptotics of these Bethe numbers when n goes to infinity in different ranges? That is an elaborate theorem saying what they are, but they kind of don't, at least in the book's not written what they are in simple terms, and you have to work on this. But so I'm not certain, say they go exponentially or non-exponentially, say Bethe numbers. However, there are part of homology which is you can understand, and this one. But anyway, it's unclear what to do with this, yeah, how to use the full information in there. But now, coming back to Moore's theory. So what is the setting of the Moore's theory? I prefer it to be energy. And what is... Again, we just imitate what people do in physics. What will be spectrum of energy? And the basic example of, because this what eventually will come up in also in this packing problem. It will be question about the spectrum, but understood in topological terms. And so what is the spectrum? So the basic example, which everybody knows, we have like Laplace operator, and we know its spectrum. So from, and this spectrum can be seen in terms of the quadratic form associated to Laplace operator, and this is energy, right? It is square of the differential. And this is quadratic form, so I always prefer to work with quadratic form rather than with operators, because there topology becomes more visible. And so what you have this. So this energy is integral of this, over some manifold x. And the spectrum, you restrict this function. So it's a function on f's. You restrict this to the sphere in the Hilbert space, union sphere. So you have a function on the sphere. Again, sphere has little topology. Topology for me is algebraic topology, meaning homology is none in the infinite dimensional space. But this function being quadratic is symmetric. Therefore, it descends to the projective space. And this is certainly topologically more interesting because topology is just generated, it's Poincaré polynomial, just it's infinite power series, one term in each dimension, right? So it's polynomial ring and one generator. So it's polynomial ring, multiplicative requires significance, so there is one generator in every dimension. And so what is the spectrum in these terms? And the spectrum is quite simple to understand. It's more, much easier than algebraic spectrum because it uses much less input. So you have a space, you have a function, and you look at the level. Imagine there's a bottom, and then it moves. And then space becomes bigger, bigger, and bigger, but you now measure it in homological term. Instead of taking mass of that, which is you don't do anyway, you take this, what I call this mu star, of the level f minus 1 of, say, minus infinity g. So I'll read this function, and you take it. For simplicity, is cut it off. Cut it off meaning I mean replace it, when I say cut it off, replace it by number. Because this is was ideal, but you take a number, the rank of this. And so it changes, and the moment it changes are the moments, the spectral points. Right? So it is a classical variational principle of Rayleigh, I guess, that spectral points of Laplacian are exactly critical points of this function. Energy function restricted to this sphere. Because symmetric, it's projective space. And it's this critical point, not just something vanishes. It's not local phenomena, it's global. So you absorb new cycle at every moment, right? So in projective space, there is circle, and there is projective plane, so there are cycles in high and high dimension. And when you, as your level grow, you engulf one by one all of them. And the moment, the first moment you engulf the cycle corresponding to this homology or cohomology, it is I's eigenvalue. So the eigenvalue enumerated by these elements of your cohomology. And more specifically, there are this ideal, the kernel of homomorphism, actually to the complement, right? Because our measure associated with it's actually ideal. So your spectrum index in this case are indexed by a homogeneous ideal in this polynomial ring, which happens to be the same as integers. And then comes this very beautiful point, which is partly motivation for what I want to say, is that there are cases when this algebra is more complicated, and one of them for this packing problem, but there is much easier case when this algebra is still complicated, which has been studied by Larry Guth, and where spectrum, where this algebra is polynomial algebra with infinitely many variables, and moreover, it's acted upon by, it's generated by single element, but not as an algebra, but as a module of a Stinnett algebra. So cohomology mode 2 acted also by Stinnett algebra, and there is a simplest kind of algebra there, the one which is free, is generated by single element. But it's as an algebra, it is rather elaborate. It has infinitely many generators as an algebra. An example of that is quite simple. The first example, what happens? It is if you consider, say, three-dimensional ball, and you consider the space of curves in this ball. And this space, properly understood, in a second I say how it's understood, the space of curves in this ball, the topology of the space is exactly what I said. Its cohomology has one generator in dimension, keep forgetting, 2 to the I think minus 1, one generator of this rank. They are polynomial, but all of these are powers, standard powers of a basic generator, two-dimensional generator there. Two-dimensional, if I'm not mistaken. But what is how you understand curves? Well, first, curves understood as a cycle, so it's either closed curve or something which may have ends on the boundary. And they're just simple curves. But you allow the kind of deformation you allow this picture. You go from this to this. So they merge and they diverge. And you can see that this is continuous deformation. And that's essentially the rule. You have to say it slightly more carefully. But then you allow a little bit more deformations. And this is, in technical terms, the space of Z2 cycles, this coefficient in this group, their relative cycle, their boundary and the boundary. And this space has cohomology, is a free module of a Stinnett algebra. And this kind of the behavior and the function which is of the interest here is the length of this curve. And so, in the spectrum of this energy, in order to understand it, you have to enumerate these eigenvalues by this kind of rather tricky thing. It's ideals and this algebra and nothing you can do. I mean, whether you like it or not, this is what's proven by Larry Good. All the structure is there. Naively, you can say, all this irrelevant is only something, it reduces to something simple. It does not. So, it's the whole structure of this algebra inside of this geometry, or spectral behavior of this functional. And this one of the easiest kind of geometrically thing you can imagine. Right. The first kind of non-linear case, and it's become the elaborate. Now, and this of course our general setting. This is our general setting. Is now we have this space, we have this function, and we want to understand how spectrum, how these levels change when you change them, and what happens in the case of the packing problem. That the function we can consider, your space will be, well, first let reduce, consider the case of finite systems. So everything happens in a ball. Which is, by the way, not the same, you cannot say, then I go to the limit. It's tricky, I mean, but it's a simplification just to not to go to the next level of difficulties. So your space is just configuration space of points. So what you work with, you have a ball, so it will compact manifold to the power I is a finite set minus the diagonal. And the basic structure there, so already this has rather complicated topology. If X is, even X is rather simple, even X like a ball, this has quite a bit of topology, but moreover, it's acted upon by permutation group. Oh, put it this way. It's automorphism with indices. If I throw away that, it acts freely, so it's a very elaborate object. It has very elaborate topology, but it is there. And the energy which you use and which you want to understand is it will be just 1 minus minimal distance between points. So in this way you can encode fact the points are far away. So being balls being disjoint, encoded by the size of this function. So the closer they come, the higher the energy. So they don't want to come together. So, and in this way you can describe, so the space of these moving balls is just sub-level of this function. And so you want to know, so what are spectral moments, how the spectrum behave, for this or that pattern. And then, so let me, and the point is, it's what was made by Larry Goose, and it was, in simple case was known earlier, that there is a non-trivial interaction between these two problems. So one, you have balls moving here, in this ball. On the other hand, you have these curves in there. In the space of curves. And between the two spaces, there is kind of a coupling. Yeah, there is kind of duality between these two spaces. In fact, this is much easier space. This is all this finite algebra, whatever, it's peanuts compared to complexity of this space. However, some part of the space is reflected here. And this part, which more or less, possibly the picture is adequate for that part of that. And so let me explain this, and I want to give kind of the spirit of that is as follows. Yeah. How we can think about what I'm going to say and about the space of balls. Instead of thinking of this original packing problem, like you're given a space, like you've given space, you want to understand how this balls live there and how they move and what are the packing. You can say, can you think of the whole manifold is just container for packings and forget all other structures. So even the say Riemannian manifold, and then for every size of ball, every number of balls, you have the space and they move. And then the spaces, they kind of not separate, they organize in a variety of ways. Because you move size of the balls. Then if you know a little bit some of this jargon, if one of them is a ball, background space, they call an operate. You can, there is an operation, they're very kind of simple-minded, yeah? Because if you put little balls here, inside, they, and each of them, they become balls in the whole space. This is kind of has fancy terminology that makes it operate. So you see, quite all these packing spaces, well organized, and they're purely topological. They depend on some real parameters, but they're homotopy types of the spaces, and they organize in some way. So it's an elaborate collection of homotopy classes of space and errors between them. What they tell you about the manifold? So what is information they tell you about manifold? And so just to demonstrate this particular instance of what is here, consider the case when it is especially simple. When you have a manifold, I say this example just because it's most transparent, of compact, this being compact manifold of negative curvature. And then the point is that you can essentially construct a geometry from essential geometry, probably all, but say essential, from knowing these spaces. Namely, you can determine the length of all closed geodesics. And this is exactly in speed, the spirit what I said, this kind of curves, there's a coupling between the two. And so this is what I want to explain. How the things are coupled in its simplest example. But in general, it's somewhat more elaborate, and this will be the end of the story. So we can see the manifold looking like that. It will be not, say it may be surface. And here is a closed geodesic, and it opens up. So it's negative curvature, it has this narrow neck, and then opens up. And we want to understand what is the length of this geodesic in terms of disks moving inside. And the point is as follows. If you have k disks, disjoint disks, and now symmetry will be not involved. Yeah? So it's very primitive kind of description, but already not so bad. So they can go from this side to this side and quite freely. But then they can go kind of back and forth. And so, of course, topology here must be understood kind of relative to infinity. But if total sum of diameter of these disks less than this length, they can go back and forth independently. So I would, if you close it up somewhere, then inside we have this product, if there are k of them, then this homology class, which is, I'm sorry, let's say torus, yeah? To the power k, this homology class of the fundamental class is in the space of this, in the space of these moving balls, right? Because they, when they meet together here, they don't prevent this kind of one from another. But if the sum of diameters become greater, so there are too many of them, this cycle is not there. So we precisely know the length of this geodesic, knowing homotopies, homologies even, or this relative homologies, of the space of disks moving in there. And that's true for all dimensions. So what is essential? The space kind of outside of this narrow neck become wide. So this is a kind of the spirit of this interaction. That they kind of make, in general, there will be not this narrow pack, but this kind of virtual kind of inside some entities, which when corresponding to eigenvalues of this space. So here, all closed geodesic on the surface will be part of the spectrum of this energy function. Right? So it's very elaborate space, yeah, which actually somewhat in the spirit of this trace formula, which is very, very different from that, of course. Yes, kind of topological. So it's kind of topological version here of the Selberg trace formula, when spectrum of Laplace operator on one hand and distribution of periodic orbits, length of periodic orbits are related in this way. So, right, so this is the formula. And so this is a quite a general principle. So there are two sides to that when you want to use it. On one hand, and this was done by Larry Goose, he constructed, this most major part of his work, quite elaborate movements of balls, of small balls, how they move inside of another, representing interesting cycles inside of the ball. Because here it's topology coming, rather non-symmetric topology, but interesting concern symmetric topology, though not for the whole symmetric group, but only for the kind of maximum seal of two subgroup, only concerning convolutions. The homology they are determined by this seal of subgroup there. On one hand, on the other hand, this can be used, so this on the size, on this part says there are complicated motion of balls representing, you can put relatively many balls into the container and they still can move with sufficient degree of freedom. And then there is opposite type of estimates. You can say, hey, if you have too many, you cannot move too much, some class are not representable. And for that, again, you can use this kind of duality exactly as in this example, right? So they cannot move with full freedom if there is this obstruction, there is this narrow cycle inside, narrow circle. But in general, it will be not individual circle, it may be moving circle, which have the same effect. So it's, here it was fixed circle moving balls, but in full generality, you have moving curves and moving balls that interact. So in the way that these curves intersect ball and move within balls, and it gives you inequality between two spectra. So one functional, one spectrum that I described is the, say, length on curves on one hand, and distance between the inverse distance between these points in the space on the other hand. And so there is this coupling between the relay the two spaces, which is probably non-faithful. I mean, it's still far from. It's faithful probably for cycles. It gives you asymptotically correct information about cycles, but hardly gives you the full information about the balls, which is by far more elaborate space. But then, of course, it's only the beginning, because even if you know all that, you have to now to go to infinite systems, and then it's not so clear how to even formulate it. Yeah, what is the density? How many balls? Etc. Etc. There are many topologies, and something you can say, but not much. So I want to stop here because I want to maybe to answer questions. Because my last lecture. And I can elaborate this or that point, but from this moment, even what little I can say become rather technical. It's not, it cannot be exposed in a short space. Larry Goose. Okay, yeah, it's easier. And his father is famous because he's an author of inflation, this inflation of the universe. G-U-T-H,
yes.
G-U-T-H. Goose. No, this is famous Goose, famous name. He, you know, this inflation, his inflation of universe, his creation. And also, just on the internet, I found he won price the worst possible office, having largest mess in his office. And it's indeed, it's impressive, yeah. We're all good at that, but he's,
MIT.
Yeah, and this is really impressive, I must say. Yeah. It was like that, in the level of books in the book, average in the room, yeah. Before I saw Milner, Milner was pretty good at that also, but nothing compared to Goose. And a lot easier you can find his articles, and I give references in my text to his papers. Yeah.
When did he begin this work?
Larry's paper is something 2007, I guess. Oh, he done. Larry made papers on many different fields. Yeah, he's quite a young man, but he's quite broad, and his first work was, I think, on symplectic geometry, and then he was doing that. It's also a mini-max something in Stinnett powers. But if you look at his name, you easily find his papers on the net. I'm referring to his paper, I'm sure, in there, here or there. And, but he's not concerned with packing, he's concerned with cycles. And packing, in my view, have much more juice to them. And of course, there are other comparable problems. So the subject which I didn't touch here, basically because my understanding, what I can say is will be kind of extremely vague, is what is probability theory for less. So here's a huge symmetry, and this is just you have more symmetry than in classical probabilities. Topology has more symmetries, and the results, you extend them, they become more powerful and more general due to the symmetry. On the other hand, in the application, then the major application will be languages. And so what is probability in languages? What is probability of a sentence? And that I don't know answer. I was thinking about that, and I have response, but it's kind of also less elaborate. What is probability of a sentence? And you can't give an answer, but it will be not a number. You have to create two kind of category type of objects. One related to languages, and one related to domain, where these ranges, this probability take. And then to say something. And it's quite interesting, yeah. So I can give an example which I like very much. Because you can make some experiments on Google. You take a sentence and you see how plausible it is, right? And of course you cannot say exactly what probability is, but if one appears 10 times or 20 times more often, well, it tells you something. And this is a kind of very typical. So one is some cats eat mice. Yeah. Many cats eat grass. So what is will be more common? This one, by far more common. And this almost non-existent. Yeah? This about, you cannot trust mathematics. Mathematicians say, well, the first is true, the second is questionable, it's not at all. First is so trivial, you don't say it. And the second is non-trivial, therefore you say it often. Actually, most cats is grass, I guess, yeah? Or even most probably. Yeah? I forgot which one of them is. And this will be 10 times more frequent. And this will be close to zero. Of course, with Google, but be careful with the number it gives you. It's unclear what you mean. So the range is very tricky, even when it comes to numbers. Of course, numbers are underlined in a very rough way. Numbers are there, like ranks of groups, homology groups, tell you something about the groups. And this is more elementary example. If you look at these two, pigs fly or bats fly. And this is quite much more, because this on the internet will be more common. We have more flying pigs than bats. If you naively look at the test, but then exactly there you see the counting is wrong. You cannot count by numbers. Because if you count correctly, this will be infinitely more. Pigs don't fly. You can deduce it from what they say on the internet, pigs don't fly. Because on one hand, it's said very many times. But if you look at the correctly understood probability, yeah, it will be, roughly speaking, here this will be combinatorics like that for bats. And for pigs, it will be like that, with one point. It will be a thick point, but it will be just a point. Because they usually appear in the same sentences. always the same, very few constructions, the number of grammatical constructions. You never saw, yesterday I saw a pig flying near my window. You don't say it. But for pets you have. The number of variation of construction, the number of construction will be for pigs will be negligible. For bats will be as many as for birds. Their frequency, how much they use the material, is what construction, what combinatorics they're being involved into. And this was a kind of, now people kind of realize that, but relatively recently, when the first corpora of languages were made, the word though, if I write correctly, or thou, right? Or thou, how right? Or you write this way? No. It was a kind of fourth most common word in English. Because in a certain sense, yeah, I mean, if you take it from Bible, yeah, that would be very common. Yeah. I mean, but again, it will be always the same construction. It's not, yeah, the number, you see, the, how many particular book was published doesn't make it's the word there more common, right, linguistically. And this applies to many things related to learning. Also, when you look at the so-called Bayesian approach to statistics, people say all these words, but they kind of still try to express it in the language of usual probability. It's not true, right? When you look, say, learning mechanism, of course, it's biased in statistic, meaning your probability is moving, but it's not moving in numbers, and moving in a much more elaborate structure. And for each particular instance, you have a particular class of problems, you have to guess, formalize the structure. And I thought a little bit for languages, but it's not kind of, I see examples. In examples, I can kind of explain it, but I don't see how to formalize it properly. It's very kind of resist formalization. When you formalize it, there's some problem with that. And it should be treated differently. But this, unfortunately, I don't know much to say. I can kind of talk about this infinite amount of time without saying anything, right? You know. it's unclear to me how to properly express it. But when it comes to pure mathematics, there are many avenues of very changing probability in a kind of diverting from this standard way of doing it, which is makes it kind of quite interesting. So, but again, I keep talking, and I expect your questions, which of course.
In your notes, there is a small part at the end on large deviations. Can
so this small part?
On large and deviations.
Yes.
Can you say a couple of words?
About large deviations? Okay, so large deviations, very general terms. Classical large deviation is when you have a family of probability distributions on given space X. So, for example, maybe real line, you have probability given by some densities. And then you want to know what the limit is. And typically, they, for example, may be associated to the sum of independent random variables. So they become kind of concentrated sharper and sharper, and the exponentially decay. And the question is how to determine this rate of decay. And the first result of that was due to, well, it's usually people refer to Boltzmann, but I'm not certain. Some refer to Varadhan, I don't know. I would think it coming to Euler, is essentially asymptotic with binomial coefficients, right? When you have an independent random variable. And so, in fact, for general, if you have just measure, so you convolve measure with itself, and you properly scale it, and take log and divide by n, and what happens, then you know that you have this. Then you know that this limit, I keep confusing, it will be either determines, its Legendre transform can be determined by Laplace, asymptotic of Laplace transform of the sequence, right? So if you can see the Laplace transform of the sequence properly normalized, then not surprisingly, this guy's kind of standard thing, you get Legendre transform of this limit. Right. This is one of the basic formulas, probably known to Gibbs. I learned it in textbooks of physical mechanics, but certainly written by Lanford. So this one was the main results. And then lots of elaboration of that, and but I don't quite understand kind of what is the, in what sense it's different from that, yeah. On the one hand. On the other hand, in geometry, what you face when space also is variable. And when space also variable, it's much more subtle, so what you look at. So here, as I said, you may consider not independent variable, but weakly dependent variable, and in statistical mechanics, they have that such and such sequences for which you want to know what behavior is, what the general principle. And essentially, much of a mathematical statistical mechanics is about large deviation, because this is entropy, after all, right? And there is a pretty good book by Ellis, I think, about that, yeah. Only which I browse through only superficially, but this kind of a major source. He's, the clearest writer of what I saw about that. I think Ellis, maybe I'm confused, not Ellis. I'm giving the wrong name. Maybe Ellis, I'm not certain. He wrote some books called Large Deviation Statistical Mechanics, and if you look at large deviation on the internet, you come across his article and his book. And but in geometry, so which is we have, for example, even kind of very simple case like simplices, and you can see the dimension of simplice dimension going and this with uniform measure, and you want to understand how a measure distributes. The total measure is one, and so it's maybe concentrated somewhere, but somewhere it exponentially decay. But the full picture is not that clear. So where a measure is sitting, yeah, how it depends how you look at it. Right here, you already have a function. So the function is an observable which you have. And here, this observable must be introduced. And the observable kind of natural function you have here, like distance to the center, distance to the face. Now also symmetry group acting. And in all of that, you have, I don't know, but I believe there is a good language saying what the limit is. And mathematics of this language will be, of course, this tropical geometry. You come from it's Laplace transformation, you see it exponential rate of growing on decay of something well algebraically organized. So they're well algebraically organized, it will be tropical. If not, it will be something less elegant and maybe not so pretty. And but there are lots of instances besides this sequence. If you look at sequence of compact symmetric spaces, yeah, of a particular type, and you see how also the geometry is distributed. So your basic function coming from distances or coming from eigenfunctions, how they distributed. What are the asymptotics? And this has been hardly touched. Right? This has been studied, of course, quite a bit of simplices in biology, because this is a kind of space of distribution of different kind of phenotypes, genotypes. The sphere, we understand pretty well sphere in many respects, because it's essential for so-called local Banach space geometry. So general symmetric space, I don't think they have been studied in a proper way, except what follows trivially from what we know about sphere or something similar. There was a recent very beautiful result of that kind concerning this polyhedron of bistochastic matrices. You can see the space of bistochastic matrices, how this may be distributed. There was a talk by Talagran on spin glasses, because there was a conjecture by Fies, I forgot exactly what it says, but exactly of this nature, how measure is distributed on this polyhedron in terms of particular observables. And there was explicit formula conjectured by them and was proven, I'm not certain, but by Talagran and somebody in by some mathematician. So it's another very, very interesting space, which is not at all kind of. Situation is not at all clear. But of course, I'm quite ignorant of that. Yeah, I know a little bit about these geometric examples, but I don't know the field of the whole field. And because at the beginning, what they do, it's elaborating this Boltzmann formula. And and they emphasize, in my view, what is kind of the formulas for these people are usually obvious. And then some analysis, they kind of foundational, they consider more subtle. For me, it's opposite. This what they call subtle for me is obvious, so their formulas look very complicated. So it would be hard to appreciate what they do at the beginning. And then they become go, 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 and I never followed it. So I cannot tell much. But there is a now good book, what, Stromfield, I guess, on algebraic statistics, when he kind of systematically exploits some of these aspects of that related to topical geometry, statistical thing, right? Because many classical functions, like beta function, gamma function, they all have this origin. They're exactly distribution of particular measures on particular shapes. And these are this kind of polyhedron, but then there are this quantum object like, well, quantum meaning, yes, cones, like cones in the space. I give some references, I think. There is a book by keep forgetting his name, who wrote a pretty good article about this information geometry in the classical domain. It is related also to the geometry of this Fisher metric in some instances. So, but again, my knowledge is quite superficial. Yeah, I know a little bit, but I don't really know this. Yeah. So it seems there is a kind of big emerging field, yeah, going in different directions in there, which is long prehistory and moves.